Total Info, weather.
I said, are you gonna be my girl?
See what you're doing to me. Fateful night, the car was stalled upon the railroad track. I pulled you out and we were safe, but you went running back. Teen angel, can you hear me? Teen angel, can you see? Somewhere up above, and am I still your own true love? What was it you were looking for that took your life that night? They said they found my high school ring clutched in your fingers tight. Teen angel, can you hear me? Teen angel, can you see me? Are you somewhere up above? And am I still your own true love? Just sweet 16, and now you're gone. They've taken you away. I'll never kiss your lips again. They buried you today. Teen angel, can you hear me? Teen angel, can you see me? Are you somewhere up above? And am I still? Teen angel, teen angel, answer me, please.
Why does it hurt so bad? Why do I feel so sad? Thought I was over you, but I keep crying when I don't love you.
Good evening and welcome to the March 21st, 2016 regular meeting of the Mayor and City Council. First item on our agenda is the Pledge of Allegiance. I'd like to invite Kim Yocklin, our Director of Human Resources, to lead us in the pledge. Please rise.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the Republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Thank you, Kim. Next on our agenda is reflection. And before we take our moment of silence, I would like to remind everyone that our colleague, Henry Marafa, has had a bit of a setback, and that's why he's not with us this evening. So I hope you'll keep him in your thoughts and prayers. Thank you very much. Next, we have approval of minutes, and tonight we have one set of minutes to approve. It's from the regular session on January 19th. What is the pleasure of the council?
I'll move approval of the minutes from January 19th.
Second.
All those in favor, please say aye.
Aye. Aye.
Any opposed? That carries 4-0. Next, we have our consent agenda, and this evening we have one item for consent. What is the pleasure of the council?
I move approval of the consent agenda.
Second.
All those in favor, please say aye.
Aye. Aye.
Any opposed? That carries 4-0. Next, we have appointments, and we have a few this evening. What is the pleasure of the council?
Mr. Mayor, I move a resolution of the council confirming appointments and reappointments to several committees, to the Gaithersburg Book Festival Committee for indefinite terms, Megan Wessel, Larry Matthews, Elizabeth Lewis, Melissa McDonald, and Teresa Hughes. All of those terms are indefinite. Reappointments to the Animal Control Board, Virginia Joel, term to expire in March 2019. The Commission on Landlord-Tenant Affairs, a three-year term to David P. Weber, term to expire March 2019. To the Economic and Business Development Committee, two-year terms for reappointments of Don Fatsy and John Lynn, terms to expire in March 2018. To the Educational Enrichment Committee, another reappointment, Yvette Monroe, term to expire March 2018. To the Ethics Commission, a three-year term, Ian Kessler, term to expire March 2019. And to the Multicultural Affairs Committee, another reappointment for a two-year term, Samira Hussein, term to expire March 2018.
Second.
All those in favor, please say aye.
Aye. Aye.
Any opposed? That carries 4-0. I know there are some people in the audience whose name we just called. If your name was just called and you were just appointed to something, please rise. And I want each of you to, there's only a couple of you, okay. Larry, we'll start with you. Introduce yourself and what did you just get appointed to?
My name is Larry Matthews and I've been appointed to the Gaithersburg Book Festival Committee.
Excellent.
And I'm Melissa McDonald and also appointed to the Gaithersburg Book Festival.
Well, it is a pleasure working with both of you. Let's give them a round of applause for them. Thank you both, and to everyone. We'll thank the others when we see them. Presentations. I would like Michelle Potter, Dave Ludington, Miguel Avila, Danny Murray, and Jason Woodward to join me at the podium.
Good evening. My name is Dave Ludington. I am the program supervisor for the City of Gaithersburg Department of Parks Recreation for sports. I am very lucky to do what I get to do here, and part of my job is I get to work with some very special people, and we get to recognize some very, very special people. We get to do that tonight. The City of Gaithersburg is a charter member of the Mid-Atlantic Recreation and Parks and Sports Alliance, which is a consortium of Recreation Area 8 parks departments, sports official organizations, and youth sports associations. The Alliance promotes a code of conduct that emphasizes sportsmanship for players, spectators, officials, and administrators. And we fully support this. The MARPSA Dennis Callahan Good Sports Award was named after the co-founder of the Alliance and the former director of Anne Arundel County Parks and Recreation. And it was created to highlight the positive aspects of youth sports in our area. And we are very, very proud of the people we have up here tonight who demonstrate those characteristics. The first is Miguel Avila. He's a longtime participant in our city youth sports program. He is a positive influence on his teammates, always doing the little extras to assist the team. Miguel constantly demonstrates good sportsmanship to his teammates and opponents. His coach commented that Miguel is a pleasure to coach, a great listener. He helps without being asked, and he supports his teammates and demonstrates good character in every game and practice. City of Gaithersburg and our Gaithersburg Sports is very, very proud to recognize Miguel Avila as our Good Sports Player of the Year for 2015. Unfortunately, tonight, our Coach of the Year, Danny Murray, obviously could not make it. He sent me an email saying he was working late, possibly wouldn't be able to get here. Danny Murray has been coaching since 2008, and one of my jobs is to reach into the parents and find that inner coach in every one of them, which means you come out to your first practice and your team doesn't have a coach, you're lucky, likely to be one of them. Danny was one of those. We pulled him out, asked him to coach his son's team in first grade. That was in 2008. Since then, he has coached in every season, multiple sports, mainly in basketball. This year for us, which without a child in the program, he's coaching five of our basketball teams. He has just been overwhelmed by how much he gets back from his giving to the kids, the way he gives to those kids. They will never forget. So we will get him his certificate and his award when we see him, but unfortunately due to work he was not able to be here tonight. Our next recipient is for our Administrator of the Year, and that is Jason Woodward. He's the Athletic Director of Gaithersburg High School. Known Jason for a while, got to know him very well when a few years ago he called me and said, "All right, we're going to lose our ball fields for 3 years. We need a little help." And I got to work with him. And then later, as we worked, I learned of everything he's done for our community here and the surrounding communities in baseball. He is truly a supporter of baseball. Let me give you an idea. Jason is president of the Maryland State Baseball Coaches Association, president of the Urbana Youth Baseball and Softball Association, founder of the Maryland Cal Ripken Sunday Travel League. He's also commissioner of the American Legion Baseball Association, director of the Maryland Public High School Baseball Tournament, and just recently elected as commissioner of the Cal Ripken Baseball Summer College League, of whom the Gaithersburg Giants is a member, and they play at Criswell Field here at Kelly Park. Through his coaching experience, which he was former coach of Gaithersburg High School, and now probably youth coaching with four kids. through his coaching experience and involvement, Jason exemplifies the values associated with hard work and his commitment to the youth of Gaithersburg, and we are proud to honor him as our administrator, good sports administrator for 2015, Jason Woodward.
Next, we have Kim Yockland and Tim Aylesworth. we're going to receive a presentation from the Local Government Insurance Trust, or as we like to refer, LGIT. Have at it.
Exactly. Good evening, Mayor and Council members. I'd like to introduce
Tim. Want to just pull that microphone? Yeah. There you go.
Thank you. I'd like to introduce Tim Aylesworth. He's Executive Director for the Local Government Insurance Trust. As you know, the city, along with LGIT and 16 other jurisdictions, are part of the Maryland Local Government Health Cooperative, which is a self-funded plan that provides medical coverage to our employees. One of the benefits of being self-funded is that any funds, unspent funds budgeted towards claims, are returned to the city. As a result, Tim is here tonight to present the city with a surplus check for fiscal year 2015.
All right. I think Tony and I will have to go down to receive that.
We always like that.
Yeah, we need pictures of this.
Come on, Kim.
Thank you.
I think, doesn't Kim need to tell us what the check, what the refund is? At the microphone. Or Tim can tell us.
Again, thank you for having me here tonight. And I do, Tim, I want to thank Kim and Tony and your support for belonging to the health cooperative. It's actually grown to about 20 local government members, which includes MML and LGIT staff ourselves. And it's grown significantly, and I want to thank you all for being one of the key members of that. Since the cooperative's time, Gaithersburg has gotten back $227,153 total, but this year it's $66,156. I do want to mention that in addition to that, you all belong to our property and liability program, and because of all your good experience there, if you got your rote premium with no discounts, it would be about $300,000, but with your discounts and credits, because your good experience and a long time in the program, it's only $234,000, so you get about a 20% discount off your property and liability insurance as well. But again,
that's great.
Thank you very much for having me.
Thank you. We appreciate it. Okay. Next, we have public comments, and this is the time where the mayor and council would like to hear from anybody in the public who'd like to speak on any topic that's not a public hearing topic. Tonight, we do have one public hearing, so if you're here to speak on that, then just hold off because that's the next agenda item. But we ask that you state your name and either your address or your neighborhood, and keep your remarks to no more than 3 minutes. When you have 30 seconds left, the timer will beep and turn yellow. When your time's up, it'll beep and turn red. Who would like to be the first speaker? Okay. And no one wants to be the second speaker, right? Okay. All right. Then we're going to move on, and we will invite the Planning Commission up for our joint public hearings. And we'll invite Greg Mann to the table. We just sort of had a musical chairs moment, but it's now settled. We're good. I think it is. Welcome, Phil. Yeah,
thank you very much.
Good to have you here.
Congratulations.
Okay, so we have our public hearing. Greg, take it away.
Good evening. This is a consolidated joint public hearing on text amendment CTAM 7245-2016. This amendment requests modifications to the height restrictions, setbacks, and general housekeeping in the E1 and E2 zones. This hearing was duly advertised in the March 3rd and 10th issues of the Washington Post and has been posted on the city's website since March 2nd. On February 16th, staff received sponsorship of the proposed text amendment from the mayor and city council. At the present time, there are 7 exhibits in the record file, and all exhibits are referenced in the exhibit list. All the individual exhibits may be reviewed during the course of the meeting and on the city's webpage or at the Planning and Code Administration Office during regular business hours. Any objections to any exhibits should be noted prior to the closing of record, otherwise they'll be deemed received into evidence. Staff would like to add that one piece of correspondence concerning the proposed amendment was received subsequent to staff's package being submitted. As such, it will be included as an exhibit within the next related staff package, which is the Planning Commission recommendation, as well as within the Mayor and City Council's outside correspondence. Staff is proposing the following text amendment to encourage redevelopment within older E1 and E2 properties. Many of these properties are reaching the end of their usable and marketable life cycle and thus are ready for redevelopment opportunities. Additionally, as the city is forecasted to continue to grow over the years, barring annexations, most growth will occur in the form of redevelopment of existing parcels. As such, the proposed text amendment comprises of 3 facets. The primary intent of the amendment is to increase the maximum building height from 45 feet to 85 feet and address the setback requirements as they relate to adjacent residential properties. The last part of the amendment addresses some minor housekeeping items that staff has noted during the review of both the E1 and E2 zones. As a result, cross-referencing the proposed amendment will also amend the requirements of the E2 zone, which include the maximum building height as well as building setbacks. It's important to note, if approved, the new maximum building height and setbacks would be by right as both the E1 and E2 zones are Euclidean zones. That also would mean that if there's a new building, it would have to go back to Planning Commission for review of that as well. To provide some context, the following map shows the existing locations of the E1 and E2 zones in the city. There are 2 zones. These 2 zones are currently neighboring both commercial and residential properties. As a result of these zones abutting residential properties, staff is proposing additional setbacks, which will be discussed later in the presentation. As stated earlier, staff is proposing to amend section 24-158, which currently permits a maximum building height of 45 feet, which is a height that may not accommodate a newly constructed 4-story building. As such, staff is proposing to amend section 24-158 to increase the maximum building height to 85 feet. This height is proposed in order to accommodate a typical 6-story commercial building. As shown earlier, the existing E1 and E2 zones neighbor both commercial and residential properties. As currently written, section 24-157 requires a 30-foot setback for front yards, while rear and side yards have a minimum setback of 20 feet, with an additional 1-foot setback added for each 1 foot of building height over 30 feet. With this amendment, staff is proposing to maintain the existing 30-foot front yard setback. Additionally, staff is recommending to maintain the current 20-foot rear and side yard setback, but to amend the section to require greater individual yard setbacks for buildings over 45 feet tall that abut residential properties. As such, staff is proposing that an additional 1 foot shall be added to the required minimum setback for each building height over 45 feet. To put this in perspective, an 85-foot building would require a minimum of a 60-foot setback. Staff is proposing the additional setback requirements to protect adjacent residential properties. Staff is of the opinion that the proposed amendment is sufficient in doing so, since in reality, the distance between buildings for an 85-foot tall building abutting residential would be between 70 to 90 feet, depending on what zone it butts next to. The last facet of the amendment refers to some minor housekeeping items within the E1 and E2 zones. Section 24-152 refers to performance standards, which were repealed by Ordinance O-8-92. Section 24-152 should have been removed as part of the ordinance. As such, staff is proposing to strike all of Section 24-152 and keep it in reserve. Staff is proposing to amend Section 24-153H, since it currently has an incorrect cross-reference. Chapter 9 changed from fences, walls, hedges, and trees to excavation of underground utility facilities with Ordinance O-15-89. More specifically, Section 9-3 referenced maximum height of fences, walls, and hedges. This amendment fixes the cross-reference to reference Section 24-167. And Section 24-160C requires the E2 zone to comply with the development standards and requirements set forth in the E1 zone. As discussed earlier, with the removal of Section 24-152, the current cross-reference is incorrect. This amendment proposes to fix the cross-reference. And that concludes staff's presentation, and available to answer any questions you may have.
Okay. Thanks, Greg. First off, I wanted to recognize our newest Planning Commission members, Ruth Sally Weick, who is a full member, and Phil Wessel, who is an alternate member. Thank you guys for serving. We're looking forward to what we can all get done together. I want to go back just, if you don't mind, to the map, E1, E2 locations map, and if you can just take, just go a little slower and with the cursor, just go over the areas that the public, so the public understands exactly the areas we're looking at with these
so
two zones.
So the E1 and E2 zones on the map shown are highlighted in red, so they're up in the northern part of the city in these locations here, as well as down on the south side of the city, and then here as well next to NIST, and then here as well.
Right, and just to be clear, the height, the current max height is 45 feet, which gets you about, a three-story, four-story?
It gets you roughly a three-story building,
okay,
using modern building techniques.
Okay, and the 85 foot, which is what's being proposed, would get you a six-story?
Yes, that's correct.
Okay. Questions, comments, before we go to the public?
So using less modern building techniques, how big a building was did we used to get in that height? Was it more stories?
Just going back, trying to think here. I think normally you would do a 10-story building, like floor, ceiling to floor height.
10 foot.
Which 40 feet would get you roughly four stories.
Right.
Today, you usually use a taller floor to ceiling height. So 45 feet doesn't get you four stories to get used to.
Plus whatever parapet or stuff happens on the roof, too.
That's correct.
To that point, so what is the impact of that? Because this excludes, like, air conditioning or anything above, any mechanicals or anything like that.
Yes, that's correct. And that's similar to other zones. The C2, CBD, and CD zone also have the same language that excludes mechanical equipment on the rooftops.
But that's usually screened, so it's not a problem.
That's correct, yeah.
Does the language read to exclude equipment or exclude mechanical penthouses?
Mechanical equipment. The penthouse, in my opinion, would count as...
If it's enclosed space, it counts towards the height limit.
Well, it wouldn't count towards the height limit. If it's enclosed, it's still a penthouse. It's mechanical equipment still.
Okay.
Anything else?
So if a building, if the design couldn't comply with the setback, the new setback requirements, then the height would have to be lowered until it could comply, right?
That's correct.
Okay. And I guess trying to think about the areas that are immediately adjacent to residential areas, and I guess actually most of them are, so except for the ones on Gaither Road, off of Gaither Road, and the southern, southeastern part of the quadrant of the city.
That's correct.
And on Bureau Drive.
Yeah.
Right.
It may be important to note that the zone districts have some properties that are abutting, but not all properties within those zone districts are abutting the residential. So this is specific to the property.
Okay.
All right, not seeing anything more from up here, then I will put it out to the public. This is the time where Mayor and Council and Planning Commission would like to hear from anyone on this public hearing topic. We ask that you state your name and address and or neighborhood for the record, and keep your remarks no more than 3 minutes. Do we have any speakers tonight on this topic? Okay.
Oh.
Not seeing any. Oh, yes, we do.
Good evening. The record, my name is Jody Klein. I'm an attorney at the law firm Illinois Cambie. Sorry, Mr. Hopkins, he was disappointed when I didn't get up and speak the other day.
It's true.
Before the Planning Commission.
It's true.
As Mr. Sesma adroitly observed, my client is Minkoff Development Corporation, which owns most of those properties on Gaither Road from Shady Grove Road all the way up to the Terminus Point. So from our point of view, we just think this is a great idea. If you want to encourage development in the city, redevelopment in particular, where better to put the height than along I-270? but the staff cleverly put a sort of a safeguard measure in there to make sure you do have adequate setbacks from residential neighborhoods where that does occur. But from my client's point of view, We have some older buildings that are kind of getting ready for redevelopment, and to be able to now be able to offer something with more height, more presence along I-270, all the economic development benefits that were in a memo that was given to you when you first considered this early on, it just has a lot of economic incentives to make it easier for us to attract people to come to Gaithersburg, because we can deliver a product basically at a cheaper per square foot delivered, because we've got more height to work with. And as I said, what better place to put that than along I-270, where it has virtually no impact on anybody around us. So for my clients, admittedly kind of a parochial point of view, we just think it's a great text memo. But I think that from a larger point of view, from economic development, it does a lot for the city, and it has the public interest protection of those instances where you do have single family detached. They're protected also. So Minkoff Development Corporation would encourage your favorable consideration development of this, because I think it will be an incentive to redevelopment, certainly in the Gaither Road corridor. Thank you.
Thank you. Do we have any other speakers this evening? Not seeing any.
Can I ask a couple more questions?
Go. Yeah. Lisa?
So can you explain for the public what it means when it says that if we pass this ordinance, then it's a by right that the builder can go up to 85 feet. What is the process then of a developer bringing a plan to the city, and what action does the council and the planning commission have with that plan?
So by right means that they can go up to that height requirement without, they can do it. They have the ability to do that without denial. But still, though, anything would go to the Planning Commission for review within, you know, health, safety, general welfare. If it does violate one of those three, it could be denied off of that. But again, the height requirement of 85 feet does allow them to go up to 85 feet.
Maybe to add to that, we do have some zones where the height restriction is at X, and you can go to X plus with approval.
Right.
But it has a little more scrutiny when it hits that extra margin of height. This would be all the way to 85 without that extra scrutiny. Right.
That's correct.
And then we have the additional overlay of a traditional neighborhood development, and so you can go by those criteria as well, which is more of a sort of form code approach. So you either have this sort of mathematical approach of this far in, this high, this kind of use, Euclidean zone, or you have a traditional neighborhood development.
No, I think it's important for the public to understand what we're talking about here in terms of how these plans can be brought to the city, and what a developer can do by right, and what has to have further approval and consideration. So I guess the other question I would have, in case people are out there are interested, is can you give us some examples of buildings recently constructed in the city that are this height in terms of both the number of stories and the actual 85 feet? Somewhere in between the current 45 and the 85.
Currently, I don't have what buildings are at that height or close to that height, but I can provide that for you.
So if we went into downtown Crown, most of the new apartment buildings are all five-story, right?
They're all four, but one or podium.
Four plus.
Four plus, right? So those, Drew?
Trudy Schwartz for staff. One example that Mr. Schlichting just gave me was Washingtonian South. It's an eight-story building.
Okay. Great.
I have a question. How does this impact parking garages? If I'm building an eight-story, a six-story building, rather, and I have an attachment of a six-story garage, same kind of setbacks, same kind of restrictions, or is there a connection between the garage, a parking garage facility, and a building? Any distinction there that's made?
Are you talking about a separate parking garage or a podium?
A floating one that's right next to it, adjacent to it.
It would
part
still,
of that project.
It would still fall under the same height restriction.
And setbacks
as well.
Okay.
But the height restriction would be taken off the height of the garage. It would be considered a separate building if it wasn't part of the main building.
Yes.
We do have zone districts that that regulate height by floors or stories. This is specific to a feet. So it wouldn't matter whether those stories were being used. It wouldn't matter if it was five really tall stories,
right,
or eight really short stories. This is 85 feet is the 85 feet. So.
Okay.
So assume we were to approve the 85 foot maximum requirement here, or limitation,
And seeing that it is by right, because it's a Euclidean zone, could you walk me through what control, if any, we would have in approving or disapproving, you know, certain heights below 85 feet under this zone? And because my particular concern is the height of those buildings close to residential zones. Mm-hmm. You mentioned safety, welfare. What could you walk me through what your understanding is as to how the city could perhaps limit the height, given that this is a Euclidean zone?
The Planning Commission, the Planning Commission could restrict the height if it did fall under the health, safety, general welfare of it.
What does that mean? Can you give me some examples?
Maybe I could clarify a little bit. When we do the site planning process, when it comes in for a site plan, we would make sure that it's meeting all of the zone district standards, and those are parking, building height, any design standards that are involved in the zoning district. Were they to meet all of those, they have a right to build that building. So the restrictions would only come if, for some reason, those by right issues, height, you know, setbacks, whatever, were causing some problem in life safety issues. That's a fairly hard standard to meet, and that's why we use the term by right. Were they to come in and meet all the standards of the zone district, there is relatively little control over saying you have to go shorter.
Was there any thought given by staff, kind of what John had proposed, which is, or discussed, I don't know if he was proposing it, you know, 45-foot height requirement by right, and then having some kind of waiver up to 85 feet, so there is more control on the part of the Planning Commission and the City Council in particularly controlling the height of buildings in near residential areas?
We did look into that early on in the drafting of this option. Were we to use that, the safest way to do that is to have some sort of findings that if you meet in these findings and you know, you have to, when you're making that decision, it can't be an arbitrary decision. You have to say, you know, this person gets to go extra height because they've met these findings. And that's where it got difficult for staff, is to decide in what reasons they wouldn't be allowed. And most of those reasons were adjacency to residential, and that's where we felt it was a simpler process to actually add those restrictions right in the formula, so that if they're adjacent to residential, the higher they go, the farther they gotta be away from the residential property.
It fulfills intent, but it gives a very predictable way for a landowner or developer to fulfill that intent. So there isn't the sort of question mark of a waiver or having to meet somewhat nebulous, you know, requirements. So it's a nice streamlined way to make, you know, some zones where you want some density, you know, to be an effective, quick turnaround for redevelopment. I might just add that 85 feet is a wonderful sort of dimension, just from a construction standpoint. You know, typically, we're looking at over 13 feet 4 for steel buildings these days, particularly in the suburbs. So it makes for a good 6-story steel office building. It also makes for a good, from the building code standpoint, it's the max out for a something similar to Crown Farm, which is the stick residential over a podium. So that sort of, you know, town center kind of concrete podium with stick above, it's a type 3 maximum at 85 feet. So it hits a building code threshold as well. So it's kind of a nice, it's a smart way to do a Euclidean zone.
End of the ladder.
Yeah, right. It's the end of it's an end of a fire ladder, yeah.
So again, just one last point for the public is that these are, the E-zones are designed to be employment centers, because one of the long-term goals of the city is to continue to have jobs here and not just residential. So for, we want to have certain zones designated as places where buildings and jobs can be located and encouraged.
Anything else from anyone?
So the only comment I'd make, I think in moving into the recommendation, maybe a quick diagrammatic section showing the set, but the relative setback to height, and almost like the triangle model like you see in old zoning codes, just to kind of give everybody a better kind of a graphic sense of what the impact of moving from 45 to 85 is. And, yep.
That's a great idea.
Or the benefit, I guess, I should say, not the impact. That might illustrate a little
diagrams.
Better.
Diagrams are awesome.
Diagrams are good, yeah. Yeah, if there could be color on it, even better.
In perspective, would be good.
So you want to move on to the recommendations? The record staff.
Sure. Look at my microphone.
Mike, were you going to say something?
No, I was just going to say, you know, the building, the setback has to be as wide as the building is tall, basically,
right.
From the rear of the building. That's a pretty significant test or requirement.
Constraint,
so,
yeah.
You know, it's not going to be in somebody's rear window.
Fair enough.
There's going to be, and you know, any other building on the other side of that property line is going to be setback as well, so it's going to be an additional footage beyond that. So that, anyway, that's just an observation I think that might help people understand what we're talking about.
Sure. Okay. Staff recommends that the Planning Commission hold their record open until 5 p.m. Monday, April 11th, 2016. That's 21 days, with anticipated recommendation on April 20th, 2016.
So moved. Second.
It's moved. Moved second, and all the favors say
aye.
Did I get an aye over there? Okay. Yeah, okay. That passes unanimously.
You new guys see how that worked? I just want to make sure. Okay, staff recommends that the Mayor and City Council hold their record open until 5 p.m. Monday, April 25th, 2016, which is 35 days, anticipating policy discussion being on May 16th. What is the pleasure of the council?
So moved.
Second. All those in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Any opposed? All right, that carries 4-0. Thank you very much.
Just an observation, they weren't as fast.
Okay. Thank you, Planning Commissioners.
All right, thanks.
Next, we have from the Mayor and Council, and we're going to start tonight with Council Vice President Sesma.
Well, good evening, everybody. I want to say happy spring to everybody. It's the second day of spring. It's not going to feel like it tonight. But perhaps by tomorrow afternoon it'll feel like spring. If you've got any tender vegetation that could be moved indoors or covered this evening, you should be out there doing that right now. So I'm just, on behalf of our former colleague Kathy Driscoll, I thought I would add that, as she always advised on that. So anyway, the days are getting longer, which is nice, and so you're preparing for spring. I don't have a lot to describe today or to talk about, other than to perhaps review some of the things. The reason I missed the last regular meeting is I was at the National League of Cities meeting March 6th to the 9th at the Congressional Cities Conference that meets in downtown Washington, D.C. Lots of good information. It was nice to see City Manager Tom Sello and our council colleague Wu down there at some sessions on transportation and infrastructure and things like that. I'll let them tell you about what they heard. I think lots of good, useful information to be shared with staff. But I wanted to bring to your attention a couple of emergency resolutions that the Board of Directors passed on behalf of the League. And at first hearing, they might not seem particularly relevant to our city, but they are relevant to many cities and to many of our residents. The first resolution was a resolution to form a heroin opioid city and county task force project to address the issue of the seemed to be increasing epidemic of heroin opioid addiction that is spreading from that is growing worse and worse and actually appearing in rural small communities in the rural U.S. as well as basically communities of every size. It seems to have no compartmentalization based on socioeconomic demographics or race or ethnicity or anything else. It's a problem that's been around in many communities for years, but it's getting worse. I hope that we don't have a severe problem here, but we know in the state of Maryland or in Gaithersburg or Montgomery County, but we know there are problems here, and we know that some arrests that are made in terms of drug distribution are associated with this problem. Governor Hogan has commented on this recently and asked the state legislature to address this issue as well. So This will be a combined task force combining the members from the National League of Cities and the National Association of Counties to address this issue and provide advice and suggest ways in which Congress might act to address these issues and help cities address these issues. Both, and it's certainly an issue that goes beyond policing. It includes a lot of other programs to address this particular issue. The other issue that the other emergency resolution that the league passed was an issue related to safe drinking water and water infrastructure, and this was stimulated by the crisis in Flint, Michigan. So the committee that I used to chair, the Energy, Environment, and Natural Resources Committee, hosted two members of the City Council from Flint, Michigan, in which they described what their citizens are going through and how this whole process happened. The entire Maryland Michigan delegation was there as well. I mean, not at that particular committee meeting, but attending the meeting to meet with their members of Congress to talk about this issue. So the league passed a resolution uniting cities on a call for action, call to action for federal support for Flint, Michigan, and other cities encountering similar problems with safe drinking water to address water infrastructure nationwide. So we're talking about water infrastructure. It's not just drinking water. It's addressing water pollution. It's addressing stormwater infrastructure. It's all of that. And we learned as well that it's not just the city of Flint that's suffering from high levels of lead in drinking water. It's cities all over the United States of large and small sizes. Cleveland came up. Small cities. I mean, Flint's not a big city. It's about 20,000 people. But certainly, what happened there is another example of what can happen when a state decides to usurp local control and management of without paying attention to all the other things they need to pay attention to. So there's plenty of blame to go around. I think that's pretty clear. The federal government, the state government, and agencies, and the city government as well. But it's certainly a situation we want to avoid and want to be aware of it. You know, high lead levels have been a problem in Baltimore City schools for years. And in fact, most Baltimore City schools, if they're not new schools, use bottled water throughout for drinking. So that brings it much closer to home. So those were two emergency resolutions that the board of directors passed on behalf of the membership, and we'll be working with Congress in developing policy and recommendations to Congress on the way they can act. So the last thing I want to do is I want to congratulate our Good Sports Award winners, Miguel Avila, Danny Murray, and Jason Woodward. It's the reason our programs run so well is because of individuals like them and those that participate and those that coach and help manage the program. So we couldn't do it without them. So I want to thank them and thank staff for working with them to make sure that the programs we offer are excellent and set a high standard for everything else that we do. So that's all I have. Thanks.
Thank you. Rob.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. And I just want to wish the residents of Gaithersburg, like Mike, happy spring to everybody. I'm glad it's here, although it doesn't seem like it is. Also, happy Holy Week and happy Easter to those that celebrate. Just wanted to mention a few things that occurred since the last time we were here. On Friday, we were in Annapolis. I had the pleasure of watching Mayor Judd Ashman, our Economic Development Director, Tom Lonergan, as well as the County Council President, Nancy Florine, advocating in support of Senate Bill 1099, which I think should be moving through the Senate this week and hopefully will be passed, and hopefully will be passed by the House as well. It's an important pieces of legislation for those of you that have been following the Watkins-Mill interchange issue. We really need this project, and we're happy to see the support that we're receiving in Annapolis. Friday night, I had the pleasure of being invited to the Metropolitan Ballet Theater, where I saw an original production of Becoming Sugar Plum. I actually brought my son Julian with me and found out that he is quite cultured. He enjoyed the ballet more than I did. And And it was a great experience, and I appreciate being invited to watch that show. Saturday, I had the pleasure, and I wish I didn't have to attend this, but it's a necessity. The Muslim Democratic Club put on a wonderful presentation regarding Islamophobia, and they had four presenters, nationally renowned presenters, talking about an unfortunate situation that in the 21st century we have to be talking about discrimination against certain segments. So I just want to thank the Muslim Democratic Club for putting on such a wonderful presentation. Want to apologize to Gaithersburg Health. I had RSVP'd to attend their benefit on Saturday night, but because of the weather, I wasn't able to make it. And then Sunday, I had the pleasure, again, of attending a volunteer award dinner for ARC down in Bethesda. Seems like a very worthwhile charity, doing a lot of great things here in the community. So I appreciate being invited to attend that as well. That's pretty much all I've got. Thank you, Mr. Mayor.
Do you have a formal announcement?
I do. Do I? I do. It's under my directory. Okay. Formal announcement. After closed executive session, a closed meeting was held at City Hall by the Mayor and City Council on Monday, March 7, 2016, at approximately 9:30 p.m., pursuant to a motion adopted unanimously. The meeting was proposed to be closed pursuant to the General Provisions article of the Annotated Code of Maryland, Section 3-305B1I, to discuss the appointment, employment, assignment, promotion, discipline, demotion, compensation, removal, resignation, or performance evaluation of appointees, employees, or officials over whom it has jurisdiction. The topic discussed was a personal matter to conduct the annual performance evaluation of the city manager. Present at the meeting were Mayor Ashman, Council Members Harris, Marafa, Spiegel, and Wu. City staff present was City Manager Tomasello, who left at 9:35 p.m., and City Attorney Board. Upon conclusion of the discussion, the closed meeting was adjourned at approximately 10:45 p.m. I was late.
He was.
Yes.
Thank you, Rob. Ryan.
Thank you. Good evening. And picking up where Rob left off, I'll start with a formal announcement about a closed executive session. A closed meeting was held at City Hall by the Mayor and City Council on Monday, March 14th, 2016, at approximately 9:40 p.m. pursuant to a motion adopted unanimously. The meeting was proposed to be closed pursuant to the General Provisions article of the Annotated Code of Maryland, Section 3-305B11, to discuss the appointment, employment, assignment, promotion, discipline, demotion, compensation, removal, resignation, or performance evaluation of appointees, employees, or officials over whom it has jurisdiction. The topic discussed was a personnel matter to conduct the annual performance evaluation of the city manager. Present at the meeting were Mayor Ashman, Council Members Harris, Marafa, Sesma, Spiegel, and Wu. And city staff present was City Manager Tomasello, who left at 10:10 p.m., and also City Attorney Board. Upon conclusion of the discussion, the closed meeting was adjourned at approximately 10:20 p.m. All right, now that that's out of the way, let me echo what Mike said about wishing everyone a happy spring. Let me also congratulate the University of Maryland Terrapins on making it to the Sweet 16. Very exciting week. And
the women will do it tonight.
The women will do it tonight, we hope. We'll keep our fingers crossed. They're doing great as well. So it's a fun time for those of us who are supporters of the Terps in this area. And we wish them luck. I also want to add my congratulations to the MRPSA Good Sports Award recipients who were honored this evening, and also all the board and committee appointees for this evening and reappointees. Thank you for your service and congratulations. A number of events were already mentioned. I just want to run through really quickly. Since our last formal meeting, we had our Maryland Municipal League luncheon in Annapolis for all of the municipalities in Montgomery County. It was a good opportunity to talk to our state legislators about our municipal priorities. It was a good event, so thanks to all who were involved in organizing that and making it a success, including our own Monica Marquina. March 11th was the Young Artist Award concert that a few of us attended. It's always an outstanding event, and we always joke that it's the one night a year when you feel the most like a failure, because you're sitting there in the audience watching these very young students perform these absolutely amazing works of music, and they're just incredibly talented, and you think, what have I done with my life? But it's truly a wonderful evening, and it was a great opportunity to see the best in music and culture that our area students have to offer. So thanks to all of them, their music teachers, their parents, and all of the folks who were involved in sponsoring and organizing the concert, which is always a wonderful event every year at the Arts Barn. The St. Patrick's Day Parade, have we had a meeting since the St. Patrick's Day Parade? We haven't.
No.
So again, congratulations to everybody who was involved in the St. Patrick's Day Parade, another wonderful annual cultural event of the city. Had a lot of fun riding on the city trolley with everybody this year. And thanks to all the folks who participated from different groups, community groups, Irish heritage groups, other cultural heritage groups and dancers, and everybody who made it such a great success. Certainly our city staff and volunteers as well. On March 17th, County Council had their annual meet and confer with our chapter of Maryland Municipal League, and again, it was a good opportunity for us to sit down with a handful of the County Council members and talk to them about priority issues. Certainly, the Watkins Mill Interchange was one of the main points of discussion, and we appreciate the county's continuing support of our efforts on that front. And then this past Friday, the city's Economic and Business Development Committee met for their annual monthly regular meeting, and had a good discussion there as well about a potential development project. And so we've been very busy, and budget season is upon us, and we appreciate everyone continuing to stay attentive to city matters and offer your input as we start to get distracted by other things and better weather, but we can enjoy all of those things as well. Rob mentioned Holy Week. I did also want to mention that Purim, the Jewish holiday of Purim, is this week as well. So wishing a happy Purim to all who celebrate that holiday as well. And that's all I've got this evening.
Thank you, Ryan. Neil.
All right, let me start with a formal announcement. The mayor and city council are seeking two positions on the Board of Appeals for one full-time member and one alternate member. The Board of Appeals consists of five members and one alternate. The board is a quasi-judicial committee that hears and decides special exceptions and authorizes variances from the strict application of the terms or requirements of the city zoning ordinance. Additionally, the board conducts administrative reviews of any final order, requirement, decision, or determination made by any administrative official or department of the city government as allowed by the city code, or the Planning Commission, or the Historic District Commission. We appeal to you. Get that? Resumes and letters of interest should be submitted by 5 p.m. That's a pretty dry announcement. I'll liven it up a little. On Friday, April 15th, 2016, via mail to Mayor and City Council, 31 South Summit Avenue, Gaithersburg, MD, 20878, or by email to cityhall@gaithersburgmd.gov. For more information, please contact Planner Carolyn Seiden at 301-258-6330. So again, wishing happy Holy Week, happy Purim to all those who celebrate any or all of those. So I had a number of transportation-oriented events over the last couple of weeks. One thing that I didn't get to was the monthly meeting of the Transportation Planning Board, because that was on the day that Metro wasn't functioning, which I think is somewhat ironic. Clearly, we need to do a lot of work, and I think that the new management group at WMATA running Metro is really... really making an effort to turn their culture around. The fact that they actually took the major step of shutting down Metro for a day in order to make some important safety fixes was a bold move that I think was a long time coming. The week before that, the Council of Governments board meeting had covered a number of subjects, but one in particular that I thought was very interesting that I'll share with you. Dr. Stephen Fuller from George Mason University came and gave his annual presentation on the growth prospects for the region over the next 25 years, including job growth and resident growth. A lot of people are planning to move into this region in the next 25 years, and something like 20% growth is expected in that time period. Figure out where to put them and how to get them from point A to point B is going to be an interesting challenge as we go forward, and I know a lot of people are working on that. Speaking of which, I was given the opportunity to testify before the Environment and Transportation Committee at the Maryland House of Delegates in Annapolis on behalf of Delegate Andrew Platt, our own Delegate Platt's bill, H.R. 1023, to study the possible extension of the Red Line beyond Shady Grove. I think it's an interesting bill. The following week was a hearing at the Senate office of Frederick Senator Young. I don't know where that bill's going. It's a relatively small amount of money, but what we're looking to see is both the transportation benefits and also the economic development benefits of moving Red Line beyond beyond Rockville and into Gaithersburg and points beyond. So we'll see how that goes. Also attended a really interesting seminar that I attended online, but that was given by the Montgomery County Planning Commission, where they brought in Jeffrey Tumlin, who is a transportation expert out of California, who really focused his presentation on managing demand for transportation as a way to improve things, not just building more roads and building more transit, but making sure that we that various methods are used in order to keep demand under control, which I thought was really interesting. And one last, I'd like to give a shout out to a family friend, Ludell Black, who I know watches these on TV, even though she doesn't actually live in the city limits of Gaithersburg, but she likes seeing me on television. She held a memorial service for her late husband, Bill Black, who we all miss very much, at the Prince of Peace congregation on this past weekend. So we all miss him, and she did a great job eulogizing her late husband, and I just wanted to say hi, Ludell. All right, that's it. Thanks.
Thank you, Neil. Did she say she watches it because of you as opposed to because of the rest of us?
Well, it's, apparently there's some televangelist who's on the same channel, and when his show ends, we come on, and because she sees me, she does watch us. So, yes, kind
of. Who knew? We were putting that out on Gaithersburg channel. Okay.
There you go.
Thank you. As Councilmember Wu mentioned, we were down in Annapolis last week. Economic Development Director Lonergan and I testified on the bill that would sort of force the state's hand on beginning construction of Watkins Mill Interchange, and we're keeping a close eye on that. We were at the Senate side. It made it out of committee that day, and we'll see how it does in the full Senate. It should either have received a vote this evening or will tomorrow, hopefully. I wanted to mention that we're getting closer to the Gaithersburg Book Festival. In fact, it's exactly 2 months from today on May 21st. If you're looking for information, GaithersburgBookFestival.org, just to give you a taste of some of the awesome authors that will be coming to City Hall grounds and speaking with us that day. NPR's Diane Rehm, she'll be in conversation with Eleanor Clift. Novelist Mary Kay Andrews, who's got a whole bunch of bestsellers. Mystery writer Jeffrey Deaver, sports writers John Feinstein and Tim Kirkjian, political folks E.J. Dionne, Juan Williams, children's authors C.C. Bell, Jennifer Childenko, Deborah Wiles. These are some really big, outstanding authors that are going to come to meet us. Not to mention celebrity chefs. We have Patrick O'Connell from the Inn at Little Washington, Eric Repair from Top Chef, and who knows what other shows the guy is on. He'll be in conversation with Brian Voltaggio and John Shields will be there. So we have something for everybody. Please make plans to join us. It is free to attend, free to park. Bring friends, bring neighbors, bring everyone. GaithersburgBookFestival.org. There is no work session next week. However, we do have a council and the communities meeting scheduled on March 30th, which will take place at Diamond Elementary School. It's meant to serve the communities of Orchard Place and Diamond Farms. The next regular session of the Mayor and Council will be April 4th. So it is my understanding that we need a motion to conduct a closed executive session this evening. What is the pleasure of the Council?
Mr. Mayor, I'll move that the Mayor and City Council of the City of Gaithersburg conduct a closed executive session tonight, Monday, March 21st, 2016, immediately following this scheduled regular session, pursuant to the General Provisions Article of the Annotated Code of Maryland, Section 3-305B7, to consult with counsel to obtain legal advice. The topic to discuss is the implementation of permit parking programs.
Say that three times fast. All those in favor, please say aye.
Aye. Aye.
Any opposed? Okay, that carries 4-0. Thank you very much. Next is from the city manager.
Thank you, Mayor.
Just a couple items. I thought that staff and the community of nonprofits did a good job at the landlord breakfast last week. Thank you for attending. I thought the video that was shown was particularly powerful about how easy it is to become homeless or near homeless. And then some of the question and answer later was pretty spirited
as
well.
It was very powerful.
So congratulations to staff on that. Moving on to some legislative things, you had asked us to look into the potential to ban polystyrene products in the city, as the county has done. I said we would send you a memo and an economic development impact analysis on that. Those are both complete, and you'll get those this week. At this point, staff, we'll either, it appears to be a fairly cut and dried issue, but as you'll see in the memo, we can either bring it back for a full work session, or we can decide to just simply go ahead and take staff's recommendation. But you'll get the memo, and it'll be
okay.
Kind of self-explanatory.
We'll look forward to that.
The other administrative thing was the pest control or pesticide control ordinance for Montgomery County. The county is still not exactly sure how they're going to enforce that, so we have to continue to follow that. Though there is legislation, you probably know, going through both the House and Senate at the state right now, the Pollinator Support Act or something along those lines, that would bring statewide guidelines to those types of products. So since we're so close to the end of the session, we're going to wait and see how that turns out as well. It seems like some statewide structure would be really useful. Whether or not it exceeds Montgomery County's, we're not sure just yet, but since we're so close to the end of the session, we're going to wait for that and then give you the memo that we owe you.
Okay.
And that's it.
All right. Next, we have economic development update with Tom Larkin.
Thank you, Mayor. Good evening, everybody. A few quick bullets. Last Thursday, I was happy to attend once again the International Council of Shopping Centers, ICSC's Mid-Atlantic Conference at National Harbor. As always, dozens of retailers from around the region who are looking at new locations in the D.C. region were on hand to meet with people like myself and developers, many developers familiar with Gaithersburg, Federal Realty, BP Realty, and the Peterson Group were all well represented there. Valuable industry presentations, roundtable discussions, and Joe Scarborough, of course, presenting over lunch. Fun conversation, especially in the presidential year. So thank you, as always, for allowing me to attend this event. Secondly, wanted to mention last Wednesday we were pleased to have Mayor Ashman join Ike Leggett and Deputy Secretary of Commerce Ben Wu for the ribbon cutting at Targeted Microwave Solutions, or TMS. TMS is a microwave process developer, not microwave foods, but the technology for
although they said they could make an immense amount of popcorn very quickly.
They could. I thought they would do it at the reception. They do specialize in clean emission, high throughput industrial drying solutions, or generically, the company utilizes microwave heating to upgrade the commercial value of raw materials for virtually anything. The company's technology personnel are now headquartered here, though the company started in Vancouver, but their R&D is now here in Gaithersburg in an 8,000-square-foot facility at 203 Perry Parkway. There's only about 6 people currently working at the site here, but ultimately they expect to employ about 30 people here at the site. Interesting technology, but what's further driving the confidence and pride in this company that it's actually Dr. Jim Young's newest company, you may recall. He is formerly the president of R&D for MedImmune prior to their acquisition from AstraZeneca. He's also chairman of the board for Novavax, so some local roots.
He has a pretty good track record.
He sure does, so gives us even more confidence in this new company.
He likes Gaithersburg, too.
Yes, he does.
Yes, he does. Thirdly and finally, it wasn't just the Watkins Mill interchange that brought economic development staff to Annapolis in the past week or so. On Saturday, March 12th, Sharon Disk and I testified before the House Appropriations Committee and the Senate Budget and Taxation Committee in support of bond bill financing for the Old Town Park Plaza project. A special thank you to Senators Kagan and King, as well as Delegate Barve, for the sponsorship. We requested $300,000. We're told there's a lot less than that that's available this year, but we're confident we'll get something. So, fingers crossed.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Okay, next we have ordinances, regulations, and resolutions. And I'd like to invite Michael Johnson, Director of Public Works, to the podium.
Good evening, Mayor, members of the Council. The resolution before you for consideration this evening is one to authorize the city manager to award a contract for construction contract for the reconstruction of vehicle bay drains at the public works facility. To give some background, the original drain pipes were metal when they were constructed somewhere in the early 80s, and a lot of the effluent from the shop is salty, and it has corroded the pipes. We also have heavy truckloads that routinely pass over that area. So many of the pipes have crushed, resulting in the shop area not draining properly. That failure to drain properly has also corroded some of the door stops on the vertical doors that we have that keep the shop safe and warm. So this solicitation was responded to by four contractors. Our staff's estimate was $130,000. The low bid was received from Garseet Construction Company from Bladensburg, Maryland, in the amount of $121,977. And a contingency of about 6.6% has been added to bring the contract amount up to $130,000. So we feel that this would be extensively the life of the shop area and address some safety and stormwater discharge concerns that we have with this condition.
Thank you, Michael. Have we, not that this would make a difference in terms of how, if I were voting, I would vote on this, but have we done work with this company before?
I am not familiar with this particular firm, but the staff routinely does their due diligence in checking references and past firms, past owners that they worked for, and they were satisfied that they were able to provide quality work for the price.
Great. Any questions, comments?
Just one question. Do we have a sense of what the potential useful life of the PVC pipes that are going to be put in to replace the existing ones would be? You know, I assume it's much longer.
It's quite a bit longer. I don't think they've yet determined the life of the PVC. It's that long. It's that long.
All right. That's all I need to know.
Still going.
Yeah. So, do we have any idea of why the disparity, from 121,000 to 310,000 in terms of the differences in costs?
Well, I have a saying when I see price spreads like this, the high number is I don't want the job price. We feel that when the contractor's price comes in close in line with staff's estimate, that it's a fair price.
Okay. At 310, they weren't going to use PVC. It was going to be diamond. Any other questions or comments?
I'll move the resolution.
Second.
All those in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? That carries 4-0. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Next, we have Stephanie Walker, Director of Finance Administration, and we're going to talk about the procurement policy first.
Thank you. I was here approximately a month ago at a work session where we discussed the draft procurement policy and made two changes based on the feedback from this body. The first was to adjust the purchasing threshold for which solicitations are required from the $25,000 that had been proposed back up to the $30,000, which is where it currently is. And then we've also added a sentence within the policy directing the regulations manual, which is really where more of the procedure type documentation will follow to ensure that we're including transparency as part of the scope of those regulations. I'm also working with our PIO office on adding a landing page on the website so that we can, for any pending and awarded solicitations, we can have a separate page that will include the original solicitation document that was issued, any addendums, and then the results from the proposals that we received, including who was the selected vendor and what those dollar amounts were. And those were the only changes to the draft policy. I'm happy to address any questions.
Thank you, Stephanie. Please.
I just want to say I think that adoption of this policy is going to be a big step forward in our efforts. It's not the end game, and obviously as we test out some of these policies, if we see they need to be tweaked over time in the coming months and years, we'll do so. But I think this represents a really good step forward. You did mention the regulations manual. I was just curious, as a sort of procedural point, is that something that comes before the mayor and council, or is that just something that, and maybe this is a Lynn question, but something that staff puts together to implement this policy once it's passed, assuming it gets passed.
Yeah, part of this policy would allow for the regulations manual, but that would be something that would be done at the staff level, so that would be approved by the city manager.
Okay. Well, I don't know if anybody else has questions, but...
No, I'm glad to see this move forward. I think we're at a place where we can be confident that that our process is more transparent and hopefully more efficient. You know, both of those things should save us money.
And as Ryan said, I mean, this represents a step in the evolution from the smaller sort of organization to the bigger city, more formal processes. So I think it's great. So if someone wants to,
I'll second.
You moved it. Right?
I'll move the resolution if I haven't already.
I thought he moved it.
But
I'll second.
Okay, all those in favor, please say aye.
Aye. Aye.
Any opposed? That carries 4-0. Thank you very much. And Stephanie Walker, introductions.
The next item is introducing the ordinance that will be used to adopt the city budget for the next fiscal year, as well as the property tax rates. And this is just an early step, I guess I would say, in the budget process. We'll start by introducing the ordinance so that when the public hearing is scheduled, that the public has some notice as to what the dollar amounts are that are being proposed. So included in the ordinance are anticipated revenues, proposed expenditures, proposed transfers, and we have a new line this year that I'll just point out, which is other revenues appropriated for our stormwater fund. That relates to, we did establish stormwater fee structure in the past, and so we've called that out on a separate line within the resolution, the ordinance this year. And there are a number of the other steps that would occur as part of the budget process before the budget would be considered for adoption in June 6th. And some of that is we'll be posting this within the Washington Post. We will prepare the detailed budget workbook that will be distributed either electronically or in paper format to the mayor and council, as well as being available online to the public. And that is proposed to occur by April 6th. We'll have the public hearing for public comment on April 20th. And then the record we would propose to be remaining open until May 11th. And at this time, I'm happy to take any questions you have on the ordinance or on the process.
Thank you. I appreciate the fact that the budget will be available to the public online on, we're targeting April 6th on our website, and they have a couple weeks to sort of look at it and digest it before the public hearing on the 20th.
Correct.
Any further questions, or does someone want to introduce? Move to introduce?
Move to introduce.
Second.
All those in favor, please say aye.
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 Any opposed? That carries 4-0. And Stephanie, now you get to do the notification of a public hearing for the constant yield tax rate.
Thank you.
Yeah.
Last but certainly not least, we are required under state law to hold a public hearing if the tax rate proposed for the fiscal year exceeds what's called the constant yield tax rate. And what that means is the constant yield tax rate is the tax rate that would be calculated if the total dollar amount of taxes was left the same this year as compared to last year. So if you assumed zero growth in your property tax base, what would your tax rate be? And so, in accordance with state law, the city's assessable base did increase this year, which is a good thing. And that would cause, if we left the tax rate the same at the 0.262 level, for the tax revenue to increase over the prior year. In order to approve that, the city must hold a public hearing in order to inform citizens of that tax increase. This would result, based on the change in the assessed values, and a 2% increase over the fiscal year 16 tax. And included in the packet information is a draft of the public notice, which is drafted in accordance with state regulations as a boilerplate formatting there. I'm happy to answer any questions you may have on that.
Thank you, Stephanie. Any questions?
Nope, I assume if I don't, someone else will give our annual speech about what this means and what it doesn't mean, which is that it does not mean that there's any proposal to change the property tax rate for the city this year.
Right. This is we do this in accordance with state law.
Right.
Doesn't it also mean that our tax rate is actually pretty low compared to cities of comparable size in the state of Maryland, and even cities of smaller size?
That it is, and I should have noted that the tax rate has been the same since fiscal year 11. So it has been very, very steady.
And it's changed once in about 45, 46 years. But anyway, we don't have to take any actual action on this. That was just an announcement.
No, we're just bragging.
Yes.
Also, it's also to avoid confusion. Yes. Because some people hear the concealed tax rate and don't really understand whether it means that there's a proposed increase in the rate. And so we just remind everybody, this does not mean there's an increase in your tax rate.
Correct. Right. Thank you, Stephanie.
Thank you.
Do we have anything from the city attorney?
Nothing.
From any other staff? Okay. Not seeing anything, then I will remind you, we have no work session next week on Monday. However, we do have the Council of the Communities on March 30th, and then the next regular meeting of the Mayor and City Council is on April 4th. Until then, let's do great things, Gaithersburg. We are adjourned. Yeah.